Welcome, everyone. We're just going to get started as I think more people are going to join. Thank you to Danielle, Penny, Megan, and Jane. Great to have you enter in the chat box where you're calling from, what country, and what organization, so that we know who's online. Please feel free to network and chat with each other, along with listening to our wonderful presenters today. And without further ado, we will get started. So today we are going to talk about ensuring accessibility, addressing the menstrual needs of people with disabilities. We have two true experts on this issue, Jane Wilbur, who's at the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine, and Megan Tucker, who is at UNICEF. So just as a small reminder to those of you who haven't seen it yet, this is our schedule for the coming year. Our next periodplasty webinar will be in February. We'll be talking about family planning and the links to menstruation. And you can read the rest of the list below. We can put in the chat box where you're going to be able to register if you want to get the sign up to get announcements about all of our webinars so that you don't miss any. In another month or two, we'll announce the webinar series schedule for the fall, summer and fall. Okay, moving along. Future webinars, as I just said, not only can you sign up to receive the webinar, but we also want your ideas. We've been generating, from what we've heard from people, different possible topics and speakers from around the world, but we welcome all suggestions, since a main idea of the periodplasty webinars is to connect people, to put out there for us all to learn together what you think are the most important topics on the issue of menstruation globally that we can be learning from each other about. Please also, we encourage you to share the webinar invitations and announcements with your networks, whether that's you're in an academic institution and all your students maybe want to learn about periods, or a non-governmental organization or government or donor or wherever you are, please spread it wide and far so we can build the periodplasty network of people connecting with each other. And wonderful to see we have multiple continents signing in the chat box, which is really terrific. As a reminder, last month's webinar, we had two wonderful speakers who spoke on the International Day of Human Rights and talked about unpacking rights, dignity, and agency. All of the webinars within 1 week of having been live are available online, and we've had quite a few hundred people downloading. Please feel free to build them into your online classes, to share them with your networks, potentially show them at meetings you have. They're there to be used, so please don't hesitate. And if you have any trouble downloading, just let us know. I just like to sort of put out there to make sure we're all on the same page, although as I've said in past webinars, and this is Marnie, sorry I didn't introduce myself at the beginning, this was the definition that was created back in 2012 as part of the lobbying for the new Sustainable Development Goals, when the global community or some people working, particularly in the water sanitation sector, realized we needed a definition around which to coalesce. Clearly, the definition needs to become more inclusive in terms of only speaking to women and girls here. And there are many great articles coming out and discussions around how we can broaden out this definition, find better ways to measure it, and all the other pieces that are really critical to the issue of menstruation. So in terms of terminology, there was a recent article that came out that sort of talked about conceptualizing or utilizing the term menstrual experience, which to encompass all things menstrual health and hygiene. So that's another way to perhaps talk about it, but really it's up to whoever is using it and what they want to use. So moving along, just to frame a little today's talks, and I wanna go quickly so we have lots of time for the actual speakers. There has been a lot, and this is really just an illustrative list. There are many other topics that have been included in the menstruation agenda so far in the last sort of 10 to 15 years when it's really begun to take off. And in very recent years, there has been growing attention to how we can measure different interventions and experiences around menstruation, and also what are the most effective interventions to be used in schools. I don't think any of us think we're there yet in terms of the evidence base, But we are starting to slowly build an evidence base around what challenges exist and how you address them, and slowly, slowly starting to think about new populations that have been overlooked so far. And that includes many. So moving on to today's topic, menstruation and people with disabilities. This really has been an overlooked area, I think, from the beginning, and happily, more and more people are starting to address it, including two of our speakers today. We thought it would be a good starting place, although they will both speak to this a little bit in their own talks, just to sort of have some common language and understanding of terminology and concepts that we're speaking about in terms of thinking about interventions around people with disabilities. So this we just took from a UN document, but sort of the three types of disabilities that may be referenced today in the PeriPosse webinar. So there's intellectual disabilities, which speak to an individual's ability potentially to really understand and manage their period, and or impacts the role of the carer, as you'll hear about today. There's hearing impairments, and Huru International, WSSCC, and others, I think, have done some work on this, as was presented in the MHM virtual conference a number of years ago, and then issues around visual impairment and the implications of that. So three different kinds of disability. There's a broader array and discussion around this, but we thought this was a good starting place. Some resources, again, this will all be posted online. This is not comprehensive, but just to give people some sense of what may be out there that could be helpful for them as you think about what to do in your own countries or in the programs that you support. As you can see, a lot of them are UNICEF. One of them is from Menstrual Hygiene Matters, which was supported by SHARE, DFID, and who continue to do work, WaterAid and others, on disabilities. In addition, when we published the Menstrual Hygiene Management in Emergencies Toolkit a number of years ago, we have a whole chapter on MHM and vulnerable populations that is not uniquely about those with disabilities, but we do have some content in there as guidance. I wanted to also highlight that the MHM in 10 agenda, which was created in 2014 as a vision for how do we transform schools over the coming 10 years, and we're getting close now, given that it's now 2020. But just to note that the those who conceptualized the five priorities of what that vision included for priority five, which is the last one, integrate MHM in the capacity and resources to deliver inclusive MHM in the education system. So that is really key that that was highlighted back then and continues to be very important. There's a small but growing evidence base on MHM, so please feel free to check out. And as you'll see, Jane Wilbur is involved in all three of these, and she's speaking to you today. Hopefully more people will start to write and publish on this topic. Belen Torrendel is one of the co-authors. She presented on an earlier PeriPosse webinar on a different topic. And Therese Mahan, similarly, is a co-author and will be presenting on a webinar later this spring. There is a Google group that was created a number of years ago, and here is the address. If you want to start dialoguing with others who are interested in this issue in particular, please email the contact person so that you can be in touch and brainstorm and share resources. Jane is an active poster on this already. Just this week, the Menstrual Hub posted a blog, A Caregiver's Perspective on Managing Menstruation for People Living with Severe Disabilities. So I think anybody out there attending, there are many of you now, please feel free to use the chat box to list any blogs or resources that you know about, that you've written, that you recommend, that you use, because I think that's a great way also for this webinar series to be learning from each other. And so just to sort of conclude the opening framing, we are less when we don't include everyone. And I think that is very true in terms of addressing the issue of disabilities in menstruation and the range we need to go. Brian, I see your hand. If you could just type your question in the chat box so we keep going, that would be terrific. Today's webinar, encouraging you to please engage with the chat box, including, as many of you have done already, sharing where you're based, what institution you're from, and finding ways to connect with each other online. At the end of each presentation will be the speaker contact information, so you can reach out to them for any questions or networking. There is both a chat box and a Q&A box option online in Zoom. Please feel free to open up both the Q&A box and the chat box. And you can put your questions directly in the Q&A box. If you can't find it, feel free to put them in the chat box. We will be collating all the questions and have some time at the end after both speakers to allow them to answer your questions. And if you're tweeting, please see the tweets to use hashtag menstruation matters, hashtag period posse presents down at the bottom of the screen. So without further ado, our two terrific speakers today. First, we'll hear from Megan Tucker at UNICEF, who's going to present more of an overview of the issue. And then we'll move on to Jane Wilbur, who will speak more specifically about some recent research in the issue. So I'm just going to turn the screen, oopsie, hold on 1 second, over, if it will let me. Okay, Megan, you should have control of the screen now, and you are unmuted.
Okay, great. Thank you so much for that, Marnie. I'm just seeing if I can click through. Okay, yes, it's working now. Thank you so much for having me. Hi, everyone. My name is Megan Tucker, and I'm a program specialist on children with disabilities at UNICEF in the New York headquarters, and I work very closely with my colleagues in the gender and also water and sanitation section on the issue of menstrual health and hygiene for persons with disabilities. I'm just trying to click through. Here we go. So the presentation that I'm doing today draws on the two guidance that Marnie also referred to earlier that UNICEF has produced on menstrual health and hygiene. One is a guidance and one is looking at key materials for menstruators. Sorry, I'm having a few issues here with the control. Let's see if I can go back. Here we go. Apologies for this. Marnie, perhaps you want to control from your side as there seems to be some challenges over here. It draws on the two guidance, one on menstrual health and hygiene and one on materials. And I just wanted to flag, as Marnie has mentioned, in terms of terminology, UNICEF is a child-focused agency. And so in my presentation, I've focused on girls with disabilities as aligned to UNICEF's mandate. But many of the approaches discussed are also relevant for women with disabilities. And in addition, I may use the terms girls and women, but I just wanted to recognize also that menstruators with disabilities also fall outside of this terminology and include non-binary and transgender persons with disabilities that may also have menstrual health and hygiene needs. Okay, if I can just go back a slide here. Marnie, are you able to control from your side?
Yep, I'm back.
Perfect. Thank you so much. Just some quick facts and figures. There are at least 93 million children with disabilities globally, and 50% of them aren't in school. So this has a really big implication in terms of reaching persons with disabilities with information on menstruation. This is particularly pertinent for UNICEF, as most of our menstrual programming has been school-based, and as girls and boys with disabilities aren't in school, they're unlikely to be able to access this information. 80% of boys and girls with disabilities live in developing countries, and so being from some of the poorest sections of communities, they may not have access to money for sanitary protection. In addition, children and adolescents with disabilities are 4 times more likely to experience violence. And this can be exacerbated when toilets and water and sanitation facilities are not accessible. So if girls and women have to go to secluded places in order to change their pads and menstrual materials that they're using, it increases their chance or increases their vulnerability to violence. And this is particularly the case for girls with intellectual disabilities. Next slide. The UNICEF guidance and our programming is based around 4 pillars. And the first one is on social support, looking at ending menstrual stigma and discrimination. The second is on knowledge and skills, so ensuring that girls and women can learn to manage menstruation. Then facilities and services, that WASH facilities are gender responsive and accessible, and materials so that they can afford appropriate menstrual materials. So in my presentation, I'm going to go through the four pillars and just highlight what are the barriers for girls with disabilities in relation to each of these pillars, and then also look at what are the key entry points. Thanks. Next slide. So the first pillar relates to social support, and some of the barriers for girls with disabilities mainly relate to social norms and harmful practices. So for girls with disabilities, they can face double stigma due to social norms around gender and menstruation. And then these are compounded by having a disability. There can be misconceptions that girls and women with disabilities don't menstruate, that they're asexual and therefore don't need information on menstrual hygiene, puberty, or sexual reproductive health and rights, which of course isn't true. As girls with disabilities are often not in schools and may be excluded and may not be included in women's or girls' groups or clubs, they are not able to kind of participate in the sorts of social mobilization activities that go on in some schools that can help change attitudes on menstruation. And then these sort of social norms and harmful and exclusion can lead to harmful practices. And one of the reviews that Marnie highlighted earlier was a systematic review that found evidence of forced sterilization for girls with intellectual disabilities in order to manage menstruation. And that has taken place in places like Australia, US, and India. Thanks. Next slide. So how to make social support more inclusive? There's some key entry points to think about. And I think for those of us that are working on menstrual health and hygiene programs, we have this opportunity to transform social norms, not only in relation to menstruation, but also in relation to disability. We can change the way people perceive women and girls with disabilities by being, one of the ways is by being inclusive in the way we communicate about disabilities. It can help to reduce stereotypes and prejudice, as well as promoting awareness of girls and women with disabilities' needs and capacities. So to think about within your menstrual interventions, whether you're including inclusive and special schools where girls with disabilities may be. If you have school-based programs, to make sure that they're accompanied by outreach for those that aren't in schools, and to wherever possible to partner with organizations of persons with disabilities. Thanks. Next slide. The second pillar relates to knowledge and skills. Because girls with disabilities may not be in school, they may not be reached by school-based interventions. And in addition, being excluded from educational opportunities, they may be illiterate and have less access to information on good menstrual hygiene practices. In Kyrgyzstan, UNICEF research found that girls with disabilities, because they weren't in school, had less friends, and this circle of friends in that particular context was critical for girls to share information on menstruation. So girls with disabilities were missing out. In addition, information on menstrual hygiene may not be in a format that they can understand. For example, a girl who is blind may need information tailored to her. If they're dependent also on carers, carers may not have accurate information on menstrual hygiene. Thanks, next slide. So some of the key things that you can do in terms of increasing and strengthening the knowledge and skills on menstruation for girls and women with disabilities is to really think about any communications, any messages, what formats they're in, and whether they can be made more inclusive and accessible. One of the key areas is on terminology. So terminology used can either discriminate or it can empower. So to be conscious of the language that you use and to avoid terms like suffering or handicapped, to use positive terms. Wherever possible, to have the participation of girls, boys, women and men with disabilities in terms of developing materials and messages, have consultations, include them. to think about including pictures of boys, girls, mothers and fathers with disabilities in menstrual hygiene information. And this information can be specifically about disabilities or any information or products that you're producing about menstruation. You've got this opportunity to represent community diversity by including pictures of girls and boys with disabilities interacting with other children. And one of the key messages that we at UNICEF really try to convey is any information that you are producing to have it in at least two different formats. So in materials for girls and boys on puberty could be in an audio format, which would reach those that were blind. So loudspeaker, radio, videos that include also audio description. And then also perhaps in a written format or using simplified words and pictures for girls with intellectual disabilities. But what's really important is that it's the same message. The same message should be produced in two different formats. Thanks. Next slide. And an example that I wanted to share was of UNICEF Kyrgyzstan, which has a menstrual health and hygiene program. Which has produced their resources in different formats. So they produce puberty books and a guide for parents in Braille and audio formats. And I love that they recognize that parents can have disabilities as well. So they produced their menstrual health and hygiene materials that were targeting parents in different formats. They also had information in video format with subtitles and sign language. And you can see an image of this on the screen. And these materials were shared with special schools, but they were also made available through the associations of the blind and the deaf, and those that were in electronic format were available online. Thanks. Next slide. The third pillar relates to facilities and services. So inaccessible wash facilities create barriers for girls with disabilities at school, but also in the community. It can lead to girls and women having to manage their menstruation in poorly lit and secluded areas, which increases risk of injuries and abuse. For girls with disabilities that are in school, there's evidence that shows when facilities are not accessible, that they're more likely to drop out at menarche, so when they start having their periods. They may have to go home to change also, missing school. And their access to assistive devices such as wheelchairs also has an impact on how they can manage their menstruation independently. Next slide. So some of the key considerations for making facilities and services more accessible. And one thing is to assess how accessible toilets and sanitation facilities are. And you can involve girls and women with disabilities in this. So you could do a walkthrough with persons with different types of disabilities to see where the barriers are for them using that particular facility. Have a look at national standards to see whether they're both gender sensitive and disability accessible. Involve persons with disabilities in the design or adaptations of wash facilities. And when you're looking at toilets and wash facilities, think outside of just ramps. Look at door widths, spaces to maneuver, and pathways leading up to the facilities, both in development and also in humanitarian contexts. Next slide. And the final pillar relates to access to materials. And some of the barriers are that girls with, say, physical disabilities may not be able to sit to change pads or materials. Girls with visual disabilities may not be able to see links, and also the affordability of issue of those materials. So some of the key entry points involve girls with disabilities in assessments. Have a look at what are their preferences for girls with different types of disabilities. What sort of materials do they prefer using? For girls and women with disabilities that have incontinence, think about the availability of appropriate size diapers. Think about where these materials are placed. So things like soap and materials for girls and women in wheelchairs, where they're placed within a wash facility. And to involve them in the monitoring of any materials. Thanks, next slide. So some of the key takeaways, and I think this is for everyone, we really want to emphasize wherever possible to have the participation of persons with disabilities in your programs, in your policy development and your research. And whenever you have a workshop or an event, to think about the accessibility of that event. Is it held in an accessible venue? Do you have interpreters available? Any information, is it in multiple formats? for programmers to assess whether your program can be accessed by people with different types of disabilities. Are your materials, your training, your activities able to be accessed? For policymakers, think about how resources are allocated and whether it includes persons with disabilities. And for researchers, to disaggregate data by sex, age, and disability to see really whether girls and women with disabilities are able to manage their menstruation with dignity. Next slide. We've got some key resources. I won't go through these in detail, but they're all available on the UNICEF website. And there's a video training on how to make materials and information more inclusive and accessible, as well as some technical guidance on how to make infrastructure more accessible. Next slide. So thank you all for having me. This is my contact information. Thanks to Marnie and the team at Columbia for this opportunity and to be part of the Period Posse. Thanks so much.
Thank you so much, Megan, and sorry about the slight issues with the slides. Jane, I'm going to try and give those to you. We may have the same issue, in which case we'll just switch it back. Just a few things before I turn it over to Jane. That was a fantastic presentation, and I really appreciate everybody posting and continuing to post what country they're coming in from, what resources they may have. We're already, thank you, Danielle, for listing the Menstrual Hygiene Day resources in Ganga and Virginia, for sort of linking and suggesting there are other resources out there that we can use and that we can access. So again, please actively use the chat box to share resources. You can pose questions there or in the Q&A box. And as soon as they start to see questions, Megan and Jane will start to answer those questions. So let me just try to turn this over to Jane. If it doesn't work, then we will go back. We have a bit of a jumpy mouse situation. Okay, Jane, you should have control at this point.
Okay, thanks, Manny. I'm just going to try. Okay, sorry, I can't right now. Okay, there we go. Okay, thank you very much. Yes, my name's Jane Wilbur. I work at the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine. So we all know that WASH is vital for MHM, but research shows that some people with a disability in low and middle income countries lack access to WASH services, or they might not have enough to meet their needs. And like menstruation, disability carries stigma in many places, and people with disabilities are also considered dirty, contaminating, and contagious. So it's very likely that people with disabilities face layers of discrimination when they're menstruating, but there's very little evidence on this, even in the grey literature. So the Disabling Menstrual Barriers research is a collaboration between the LSHTM and WaterAid, and it aims to investigate and address the barriers to menstrual hygiene that adolescents and young people with a disability face in Nepal. It's got five key objectives. The first one is to systematically review relevant literature. Second, do qualitative research to understand MHM for adolescents and young people with a disability and their carers in the Kaveri district in Nepal. So this was across all functional limitations, so all impairment types. Third was to identify strategies to improve MHM for people with intellectual impairments. So at this stage, I decided to hone it down because findings from the systematic review and the qualitative research showed that people with intellectual impairments faced the most barriers, and they also had the fewest interventions. So fourth was to develop and deliver an MHM behaviour change intervention for this group, and fifth to evaluate the feasibility and acceptability of the intervention. So in this presentation, I'm going to focus on these objectives. So just to start off with a handful of barriers from the qualitative research, there were a lot, but the first one was that the barriers differ depending on the impairment. So Megan has touched on this, but this is coming from the Nepal context. So one of the biggest challenges faced by people with physical impairments was inaccessible WASH services. Premenstrual behaviours experienced by people with intellectual impairments were not well managed or understood. So changes in behaviour before and during menstruation for this group include withdrawal, increased hyperactivity, self-injury, feeling frightened, and also going out with blood-stained clothes. So in this context, where blood is very, it's considered extremely dirty and impure, people were abused for going out with blood on their clothes. And menstrual cramps weren't well managed. The pain relief wasn't provided consistently. So these menstrual cramps can exacerbate behaviours. MHM programs are generally delivered through schools and at community level, but they don't reach all the people that we spoke to with a disability or their carers. Some people with a disability with self-care limitations can't always manage independently, so they're reliant on a carer. And this is the biggest difference with this group compared to the general population. There may be a third party involved, and that third party needs information, support, and guidance on how to manage someone else's menstrual cycle. But very often they don't have any. Sometimes they can't leave their home because of the caring duties. And it's a very, providing menstrual care is a very, very private issue. No one spoke about it to anyone else. So they felt extremely isolated and overwhelmed. So in the research, we also did photo voice. And here are a couple of examples. The one on the left is taken by Shamila Tamang. And the caption she chose for this photo is, "Water issue is also there. I would have to carry water, which is difficult." And when she explained it further, she said, "That's my crutches on the water tank. I need to use crutches and walk, thus can't carry water. It's either me carrying my two legs or water. When we don't have water, I do nothing. I just keep the menstrual cloth under my bed when I can't wash it." The second photo on the right is of a t-shirt, and it was taken by Tulasa, and she has self-care limitations. And she says, the caption is, "I need help from others to wear clothes and change my menstrual pads." And she explained, "I need help from others to wear clothes. I can't wear it on my own. If the cloth is inside the cupboard, I can't touch it. And there might not be others there to help me when I need it." So this table gives a bit of a snapshot of the barriers to MHM faced by the general population, person with a disability, and their carers. So we already know that the general population face extreme barriers related to MHM. And these impinge on human rights, including the rights to water and sanitation, information, education, and sexual and reproductive health. People with disabilities and carers experience all of these, but they also experience many more. So you can begin to see the layers. So this is where we carried out the qualitative research and where we developed the intervention and piloted it. So it's the Coveray district in Nepal, that's the red spot on the map, and on the right there's a photo of the terrain. So we created the campaign. So a creative team was brought together to create the campaign. That was me, WaterAid UK, WaterAid Nepal, Down Syndrome Society Nepal, and then three partners of WaterAid who implement MHM programs in the Coveray district. It was CURDAC, the Centre for Integrated Urban Development, Mitra Samaj, and local government mobilisers and artist and entrepreneur. So we created the campaign over a week, and then I further developed it over a few months. And we identified two target groups: persons with intellectual impairments and their carers. And each of those groups had three target behaviours. And the target behaviours were identified because some people during the formative research from these target groups were displaying the opposite. So I'll flesh this out now to explain. So we have the person with an intellectual impairment, I'll call them young person going forward, and the carer on the left. So the target behaviours for the young person was to use a menstrual product, use pain relief, and don't show menstrual blood in public. So related to that third point, it was about a safeguarding issue, because if the people who were going out, they were showing their used menstrual product to other people, or they had blood on their clothes, they were being abused for doing that. So for the carer, it was to provide enough menstrual products, provide pain relief, and show love and emotional support. So these are the faces of our campaign. There's Bishesta on the left and Prerna on the right. And Bishesta, which means extraordinary in Nepali, is a girl with an intellectual impairment with hidden and extraordinary talents. Whenever she needs support to understand the changes she faces when growing up, Prerna, or motivation in Nepali, motivates and helps her. So the campaign has a number of components designed to enable the young people to improve their MHM practices and encourage carers to support them through this process. So the intervention includes period packs that's given to the young person. So they include a branded menstrual storage bag for use at home, a menstrual shoulder bag with a plastic bag inside it to transport used menstrual products when people are outside the home, and a menstrual bin. So all of these components needed to be kept next to the young person's bed, so they always knew where to go, where they could find them. And they always had to be full. So that was the carer's responsibility. We also developed two visual stories about Bishesta menstruating and learning how to manage it as independently as possible with Prerna's support. And in these stories, Bishesta and Prerna carry out all the target behaviours. So the idea behind all of this is that participants want to aspire to be like Bishesta and Prerna, so then they adopt the target behaviours. Carers received a menstrual calendar as well for tracking the young person's menstrual cycle. So on this slide, there's a photo of two dolls. The one on the left is a large Bishesta doll, and she was used in our training. So she has removable underwear, removable clothes. She has a used menstrual product and a clean one. So we did a lot of role play around the young people recognizing when the Bishesta doll needed her menstrual pad changed, how she did that, how she disposed of it, how she washed her hands afterwards. We also have pain symbols that can be put on the dolls where the doll might experience menstrual discomfort. So the head, the breast, the stomach, the back, for example. And the Bishesta doll, the large Bishesta doll, always also had the period pack components in miniature. So the young people could practice using them on the doll before they were given them to take home and use them at home on themselves. They were also offered a small Bishesta doll, which is the photo on the right. She also has removable underwear and clothes and a little menstrual cloth, so that the young people could practice changing her menstrual pad between their own menstrual cycles, so that things weren't forgotten. So we selected facilitators to deliver the campaign from the Down Syndrome Society and the Centre for Integrated Urban Development. So they had disability expertise and MHM WASH expertise. I developed a facilitation manual, which the facilitators followed so that it was delivered in the same way with fidelity. And I trained them across 4 days, and then we tested and revised the campaign components before it was delivered. And it was delivered to 10 young people and 8 of their carers, and their carers were either professionals or mothers. And we did 3 group training sessions across 3 months. And we also did household monitoring visits between those group training sessions, where we reminded the participants of how to use the product, the campaign components, what the target behaviours were, but also just as a check-in to answer any questions, just to know that they're supported. And here are some photos from the first session. So moving on to the evaluation findings. In general, the Bishesta campaign is feasible and acceptable for the target groups, the facilitators and the implementers. So here, when I say implementers, I mean WaterAid as a host organisation. Participants used most of the campaign components, which made the target behaviours attractive and easy to carry out. and improvements across all target behaviours were seen, were recorded. So for the young people, the carers reported on their behalf, but more young people with moderate intellectual impairments were wearing a menstrual product and disposing of them hygienically after the campaign. There was increased comfort and confidence during menstruation. And one professional carer explained about a young person that she looks after. She said she was very happy. She got to learn many new things. Now she's confident. She realized that menstruation was natural. Before, she didn't used to tell us when she was on her period. She used to sit in a corner and cry. Now she tells us that she's feeling pain. She's having high bleeding. She shares those things with us now. And for the carers, they reported taking the young person out when they're menstruating now because they wear a menstrual product. So rather than shutting them away at home because there's a fear that they would show blood in public, there's more mobility. They also had an increased understanding of premenstrual symptoms, and they responded compassionately when the young person was upset or angry. And they reported being able to provide better care throughout the menstrual cycle. So the Bichester campaign is online at this website. Everything is free for download, but it must be noted that it was developed for the Nepal context, so it needs adapting for different contexts and different settings. So there are three options that we've thought about for scaling up the campaign, it's all about testing at a large scale, but it does need funding. So here are the three priorities. The first is to conduct a baseline, deliver the campaign at a bigger scale to people and their carers, and conduct process and impact or outcome evaluation in Nepal. Secondly, to develop the capacity of local researchers to adapt the Bichester campaign in different contexts, beginning with adaptations for the Pacific and the Africa region. We've actually got funding to do this in a humanitarian setting in Vanuatu, and we're looking at the second country at the moment. And thirdly, to adapt the Bichester campaign for people with hearing impairments. But of course that needs funding. So in terms of the takeaway for practitioners, this is an opportunity to ensure that one of the groups most vulnerable to exclusion, potential exclusion, from MHM interventions are not left behind. There's something there, but it now needs further investment to take it to the next level. And the core really is, can we collaborate, find funding to scale up the Bichester campaign? For researchers, we need a lot more evidence. There's just not enough. So please continue to do research into MHM requirements of and the barriers faced by people with disabilities and their carers in different settings. Just to finish off on some acknowledgements from WaterAid, the LSHTM and the implementing partners and the funder. Thank you so much for listening.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Jane. And if I can just get, okay. All right. So fantastic presentations. We have been having a very active chat box, which is fantastic. And we have a number of questions in the Q&A. Some of those are, thank you, Ganga. Great to see you online. It'd be wonderful for Jane and Ganga to connect so that you can share more widely in Nepal what has been going on. If you have any questions, please put them into the Q&A box or the chat box right now. I have a couple questions of my own, but let's keep going. And also thank you, Rebecca, Danielle, others, whoever has been putting in blog links, article links, recommendations. That's really a wonderful thing to have as part of this. So I'm just going to unmute our two speakers so they can respond to some of these questions. Oops, I didn't mean to do that. Okay, so how did you go about recruiting and creating the rich pictures for identifying the barriers and needs for people with disabilities? I think that question is for Jane, but maybe both of you could speak to how you identify the images or come up with the visuals that you use. Maybe Megan, do you want to go first? And then Jane, if you could just enter your questions into the chat box rather than raising your hand, that would be great.
Thanks so much for the question. I think UNICEF is really trying to look at how to be more inclusive in everything that we communicate about. And so we're working very closely. UNICEF's a huge organization. We're working very closely with our Department of Communication on how to make sure that UNICEF creates a lot of video content and a lot of photography to make sure that we're including girls and boys with disabilities in those. We've done, we're working with them to make sure that they're portrayed in positive light. And we've got sort of guidance available on our website as well for when you're creating and looking at photos and videos about how to make them more inclusive and accessible. So I hope that's answered your question. In terms of identifying barriers, we've worked closely with our WASH colleagues and our gender colleagues, and also really taken from some of the formative research that was done in UNICEF's menstrual health and hygiene programs. Thanks.
Great. Did you want to respond to that?
So from the Bichester side, in terms of the images, so what we had was an artist who was at the meeting where I presented the formative research findings, and the Down Syndrome Society were there as well, the head of that. And she works with people with Down syndrome, but she's also a mother of a person with Down syndrome. So during the formative research, when I was presenting them, the artist was sketching out what he thought were the visualization of the findings. And that slide that I showed with all the arrows was actually him just on a flip chart visualizing them as I was talking about them. And then through the week, we discussed this Bichester character. So he did a drawing of what he thought she could look like. And then Sheila Thapa from the Down Syndrome Society Nepal was commenting on things like the length of fingers and toes, the length and width of limbs, her height, her eye set, everything to make her look like a young person with Down syndrome.
Great, terrific. And then we have a lot of questions. So just to everybody, keep them coming. What we will do is collate them if we don't have time to get through them all. And the panelists have kindly agreed to respond to them briefly, and we will send them around when we send the recording. Jane, for some reason I can't unmute you, but if you can.
Sorry, that's me.
Okay. So at least two more questions, I think, and then we'll just check the time and see if we have time for more. One that I had and that has been hinted at by others, both sort of Ganga wanting to see this more widely in Nepal and others asking about how you can sort of fit this into the regulatory framework. I'm curious to know from both your perspectives or one of you, whoever wants to jump in, how approaches like this can be scaled, which would address sort of two of the other questions in here, which are around sort of how do you find the girls with disabilities, because they may be hidden away. So how do you do something that's sort of scalable that may ultimately then include even those who are hidden or not visible? But Penny, we'll come back to that question. And then also it would address some of the broader taboos and stigma around menstruation. So maybe Megan and then Jane, if you have how it can be scaled.
Yeah, I think for UNICEF, given that we're child focused, I think the key to scale is linking menstrual health and hygiene to inclusive education. Because so much of UNICEF's work is school-based, ensuring that girls with disabilities are in school is really key to also supporting them to manage their menstruation, and I think also to change attitudes, to look at the acceptance of them in communities and in classrooms, and to be able to reach them through inclusive education. So things like moving away from special schools towards inclusive education. You know, you could do a whole separate webinar on inclusive education. But I think for UNICEF, the key is bringing together these areas of education, health, disability, and water and sanitation so that girls with disabilities are in school, they're accessing education, and they're able to learn about menstruation in that way. And that teachers, parents, their peers are, you know, accepting and reducing some of those negative attitudes through that as well.
Great. Jane, do you have any thoughts?
Yes, I think just in terms of how do you find people, I would just urge people to work with disabled persons organisations. So these are organisations that are made up of people living with disabilities themselves. So they very often, and if you can find one working in the local area, they usually know most of the people with a disability in that area. So that's first one. The second one, the way we identified people was using the Washington Group short set of questions. So that's where you don't ask someone in your household, is there anyone who has a disability, because of all the taboos related to that. So very often they might say no when actually there is a person in the home that does have a disability. So instead, the Washington Group questions ask about functional limitations. So they cover hearing, seeing, remembering and concentrating, self-care, mobility, communication and understanding. So people who have intellectual impairments very often have a lot of difficulty or more, or cannot do at all in remembering and concentrating and self-care, and sometimes communication and understanding. So not using disability because the word, focusing more on a person's ability to function.
Can I add in there, Marnie, as well, just to say, thanks so much, Jane, for mentioning Washington Group. And there's also now those set of questions have been adapted for children with disabilities. So for for young people aged between 2 and 17, and it's called the Child Functioning Module. So that can be used also to identify younger persons with disabilities. Thanks.
Great. Terrific answer. We're just going to do sort of one or two more, and then I just have some slides to wrap up. There was a question. I think you spoke to this a little, but if you had anything to add, because one of the things we noticed when we did the menstruation and emergencies project was coming upon in the Tanzania refugee camps, male carer who hadn't been targeted with guidance and was really overwhelmed. I can't remember if it was his sister. I think it was his sister. It could have been his daughter. Who he had to help with periods. And so sort of efforts that are out there, I'm sure as hard as it is to reach female carers, that when you have a sole male carer, that may be even trickier and more challenging. Do either of you have any thoughts on or examples of where that's been done well, or where people could look, or reflections on that?
I think it's a really interesting question. Emergency contexts have such a set of challenges where, you know, girls with disabilities that may have carers and social structures to support them break down. The stigma and discrimination is very much exacerbated. I don't have any examples of fathers being supported in that context. I think it'd be really interesting to look at that, given the changes that can happen to a family within an emergency context. You may have people with newly acquired disabilities within emergencies, so having to grapple with both a new impairment as well as having to manage menstruation in an unstable environment like refugee contexts. UNICEF's done a lot of work on accessible wash facilities within refugee settings. I think a gap would be looking at both male and female carers, but also looking at some of the supplies that we provide in refugee contexts, like dignity kits, water buckets, things like that, that are needed to support, hygienic menstruation, to make sure that they're accessible. So there's definitely some work to do in that area.
Great. Anything to add?
Not really. I mean, from the formative research, only women were carers. So we wanted to develop something that was as simple and closest to their own reality as possible. Yeah. So if we, in the visual stories, for example, included a male carer, some carers or the young people might have got stuck on that aspect rather than thinking about the practical menstrual management. But I do think it's something that does need to be taken forward and expanded on, and working with DPOs to really understand who disabled persons organizations, to understand who is the carer, because it's not always the woman.
Right. Terrific. I think we're running out of time. So what I want to just do is mention what some of the other questions were, and then what we will do is our team here will collate them and send them to Jane and Megan to ask if they can just kindly briefly answer them, and then I'll just do a couple wrap-up slides. But we've had questions related to endometriosis and sort of how one addresses that in the framework. How you give the local community sort of specific attention or get them to pay attention to people with disabilities, does that work? Danielle has some questions around what innovations are out there around tools or products to help those with disabilities, and also some specific questions from Kenya. There was a question around using the menstrual cup and how that works in low-income countries. There's a pretty wide literature on that at this point, so I'm going to sort of defer that one because I don't think it's, I think it was a broader question, but just to say there is some out there and we can help to respond to that. So just I want to sort of go through future webinars. First of all, just tremendous, tremendous thanks to Jane and Megan and to so many of you who were online. When Caitlin and our team here sends out the recorded link, please feel free to share that widely with your network so they know that they can watch it even if they weren't able to join today. I think clearly we have a long way to go on this aspect of menstruation, but it's absolutely encouraging and inspiring to hear what's already out there and what people are doing and trying to do. So that's just wonderful. Just as a reminder, next month we have an exciting another webinar. It's fun to see the range of topics that have been suggested and will be including, and we will have a different format. We will have two speakers, both from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Health, talking about what I think we feel and I think many people feel is a really overlooked aspect of menstruation, is all the work that's been done in menstruation and all the work that's been done in family planning, and why are they not more linked, and what are some ways forward in terms of linking those two very important agendas, which seem very naturally linked to many of us. And we've invited Chelsea Polis from the Guttmacher Institute to do a reflection and commentary at the end of the speaker. So there should still be some time for Q&A, but we're just trying out this different format. So again, huge, huge thanks to everybody for joining us today. It's so exciting to watch the chat box and to see so many familiar names. And for those of you in very late time zones, thank you for logging on. To everybody for putting all the resources in there, that's fantastic, so people can find learning. And thanks to our wonderful MPH student, Danielle, who's actively making sure the Period Posse webinars work along with Caitlin. So see you all next month, and thank you so much again for joining us.